Go check out the excellent collection of t-shirts available at popthreads.com and use our discount code SIMPSONS at checkout to save 15% on your order. It helps out our show and it saves you a little bit of dough. Thank you again for listening to the Best Darn Diddly Review Show, and thank you for supporting our sponsor, popthreads.com. Hello again, everyone. Welcome back to the Best Darn Diddly Review Show. This is a weekly podcast for anyone who loves The Simpsons or ever has loved The Simpsons, hosted by two dudes that grew up on The Simpsons. My name is Miles, better known as Mr. Most Days Off, and today we've got yet another classic episode, a highly rated classic episode from season 4. We're going to be talking about Last Exit to Springfield, one of three episodes that has a 9 out of 10 rating on IMDb from season 4, the last of the three we have to review. And of course, joining me, as always, your co-host with the most, Richie the Whiz Kid. How are you today, Rich?
Well, to go off what you said, I'm feeling like a 9 out of 10 today. Honestly, with episodes like this, it's one of those ones where I don't hold it in quite as high of esteem as everyone else on this one. There's parts that are really, really great, but it's just, I don't really like the story in this one. It's about a dental plan, but there's a lot of great jokes in there, so there's always that to fall back on. We'll get into that as always. For now, I'll throw it back to you. The man. The myth. He's 10 times more addictive than marijuana. It's Miles.
Man, everyone, seriously, when I die, just load me in a bowl and smoke me. I don't want it to go to waste. But yeah, this episode is an interesting one because it is so highly rated, but to be honest, this was one I didn't have a ton of memory on. I remember the gist of the story. I remember the braces and the creepy orthodontist. I remember Homer being the union leader. But frankly, I think part of the reason for that is because as a child watching this episode, I know for certain a lot of the jokes in this episode must have just flown right over my head. All the stuff with the mob and Hoffa, a lot of just the union stuff in general. We're going to get to all of that, but I think a lot of this episode is definitely showcases how this is not a kids' animated show. I mean, it's not like it's offensive to any degree, but it's not a storyline that an 8-year-old is going to connect with.
Well, don't have a cow, man.
Again, the episode we're discussing is Last Exit to Springfield, which debuted on March 11th, 1993. The chalk gag on this one is mud is not one of the four food groups, which just made me laugh because I don't know if you're aware of this. The food pyramid that they taught us as children is just completely wiped away now. It doesn't even exist. And essentially, I think they used to tell us that, like, we needed a lot, like, grains were, like, the base of the pyramid, and that's what we needed the most of. And now lots of nutritionists essentially eliminate those from kids' diets. So it turns out nobody really knows what they're talking about when it comes to nutrition.
And it's going to change 15 more times over the course of the next 3 years. And it's just, it's whatever. Milk's good for you 1 year and it's terrible for you the next 2 years. And they're like, no, go back to drinking milk. It's okay now. So whatever, right?
Yeah, I just can't wait till doctors start recommending smoking and drinking again, because then I'll be the picture of health.
3 beers a day or more, you're not trying hard enough.
3 beer minimum, that's right. It's the secret to a long and healthy life.
It's the Sizzlack cylinder. I was trying to make it rhyme.
I like that. That's the new food method we're going to promote. The Sizzlack cylinder.
Hashtag that shit.
Absolutely. The couch gag on this one is a repeat. We've seen it before, but it's a fun one. All of the Simpsons jump on their familiar orange couch, and then it turns into a, like, octopus sea monster and eats them all.
Like an octopus / amorphous blob squid thingy-mabobber.
That's the scientific term. Thank you for correcting that.
Yeah, you're welcome. That's what I'm here. I am the Whiz Kid, after all.
The actual episode on this one opens with yet another appearance from McBane, and don't think I forgot, I know I promised you some more information on the McBane movie next time it comes up, and I have it for you. There's not a lot to say, though. It turns out that, just like I mentioned, they actually cut together from all of the clips that show up in the Simpsons show. They're not in order when they debut on The Simpsons, but they all connect and piece together to tell a full-fledged story. The part that we see today has Mendoza and a table full of henchmen having some sort of bad guy evil meeting with a ice sculpture in the middle of the table. Of course, McBain burst out of the ice sculpture in a total situation of life imitating art because, of course, McBain is their Schwarzenegger-like action star. And he burst out of this ice sculpture with a very corny pun, "Ice to see you."
Ice to see you.
The great part of this is three years before Batman and Robin, where Schwarzenegger was most famously known for all of his very terrible ice puns that he got to deliver as Mr. Freeze.
So once again, we need to get a soundboard for this. It's time to say it.
Simpsons did it. Absolutely.
But that before that is when you have Mendoza doing his little test tube of the swank, 10 times more addictive than marijuana. So it's not addictive at all.
Exactly. 10 times zero is zero. This clip in the McBain movie, which you can actually find easily on YouTube now, yes. And it's only about 3 minutes long.
It's great, though. I want to see this movie.
I wish they'd make it full length. I really do. It'd be great.
Considering McBain's partner got killed a few scenes prior to this
Mendoza.
One.
Well, that scene actually happens early on. So yeah. The Mendoza scene that we saw previously happens early on in the movie. And the scene we see in this episode is actually the scene right before the final showdown in Mendoza's office where he kicks him out of the skyscraper. So the scene we got today was very close to the end of the movie. And it was spoofing the classic part of any action film where it's just a bullet storm as the star is trying to get to the head bad guy. And my God, this was actually really violent. Like, a lot of people died in this opening scene.
I was going to try to come up with some, like, quippy ice line, but I couldn't do it. I couldn't find one. Keep it the way it is. I want the people to know that I failed them.
Fair enough.
Time for me to cool down.
There it is.
And we're back.
At least for now, the McBain story concludes with McBain being tricked by a poisoned pastry. It fades out to the Simpsons home with Bart and Homer watching this as Mendoza starts to laugh maniacally. Bart mentions, "Wow, that guy's really evil." And Homer assures us that it's just a movie. No one in real life is that evil.
But wait, in true Simpsons fashion, Homer's immediately proven wrong.
I love this whole sequence because they flash to Monty Burns in his office laughing exactly like Mendoza was, only at the expense of this poor worker out on a scaffold that has cracked in half and he's dangling for dear life as Mr. Burns just laughs at him.
And then closes the blinds.
That's the worst part, is like the evil cherry on top here is when he closes the blinds, we just hear a scream. And it fades out as if this person's just falling to their death. Burns is supposed to be meeting with the union leader who is running late. And it turns out he hasn't actually been seen since he promised to clean up the union. I love this bit. It's the first of many, many references to the mob in this episode. But it cuts to a football field where there's clearly a body-shaped erosion coming up through the field that a player actually trips on, and this is, of course, an allusion to Jimmy Hoffa, a famed Teamster Union leader back in the 70s that had ties to the mob and turned up. He went missing in 1975, has not been found to this day, but he was pronounced dead in 1983. The whole football bit is kind of a gag to the point that there is a lot of speculation that Jimmy Hoffa is actually buried under the Giants football stadium. But a couple of things to debunk that. One, the Mythbusters actually did a search for Jimmy Hoffa's body using technology in today's age. And second, that stadium was actually destroyed and there was no human remains found in the destruction of that stadium.
Yeah, well, don't trust Giants fans. You know how I feel about them.
Hey man, Eli Manning is unstoppable.
Just like a Citizen Echo Drive watch. When it's on, it's on. When it's off, it's zit, zit, zit.
I forgot inside jokes aren't great for podcasting. My bad.
Hey, now we can ask Citizen Echo Watches to be like a sponsor or whatnot then, right?
Yeah, I think next time we need to make sure we secure the money before we give them a plug, but I you know, we're on the right path.
Damn it. I mean, dope!
Exactly. Burns is absolutely livid with all these union demands, things like benefits, perks, and green cookies on St. Patrick's Day.
Ugh.
He has a flashback to back when his grandfather used to run the Atom Plants, 1909, where men with steel hammers were cracking atoms by hand.
I love the part where the grandfather catches the boy leaving and he goes, "Turn your pockets inside out." And the kid's got all these, like, crumbs on his pocket.
Six atoms!
He goes, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 atoms! Like, you can actually physically count atoms the way Burns remembers it.
And he actually gets fired for this atrocious theft.
That's a really funny scene.
The great part is, though, this kid then gives this little speech that's just too funny and too on the nose, because he talks about how one day all the workers are going to come together and they're going to form a union and they're going to make things right and fair. And then they're going to take it too far and get corrupt and ruin it all.
And shiftless. And the Japanese will eat us alive! Except replace Japanese with Chinese and they hit the nail on the head.
And then we're back in real time where Burns says, if only we had listened to that boy instead of walling him away in an abandoned room. Which, oh my god, how evil is this man?
Well, technically that was Burns' grandfather.
True, that's a good point. I guess evil runs in the family.
You are what you're raised to be.
Retelling this story of his grandfather fires up a passion in Mr. Burns, and he decides he is going to fight this union. He's going to take back this dental plan. In a great segue to the B-plot, we cut to Painless Dentistry, formerly Painful Dentistry, where Ralph Wiggum is getting a checkup.
How often do you brush, Ralph?
Oh, 3 times a day, sir.
Why must you turn my office into a house of lies?
I don't brush. I'm sorry. I don't brush.
Let's look at a picture book. The Big Book of British Smiles.
Make it stop, please. I've seen enough. So this Big Book of British Smiles, we recently did the guest spot hosting the Secret Transmission podcast, and I guess it awakened a detective spirit in me, Richie, because I wanted to look more into where this claim that the British have bad teeth came from, and it turns out that it's widely a myth that just caught on like wildfire, partly to do with comedians back in the 80s and 90s, and it was really cemented in with the popularity of the movie series Austin Powers, which made a lot of jokes at British teeth expense. But, again, it turns out that for the most part, these claims are wildly untrue. It is true that it took England a little while longer to adopt things like whitening and braces than the United States
fighting
did.
Fighting gingivitis.
But ultimately, the actual cleanliness of the teeth has always been the same. It was said that the British, for the most part, cosmetically appreciated a more natural look, which is where some of these claims came from. But in terms of hygiene, and many studies have shown that British children actually have better dental hygiene than American kids do.
For the record, I'm not laughing at British teeth. I'm laughing at the seriousness and the tone of your voice talking about this and the facts behind it.
Hey man, I take my secret transmission journalistic duty serious, all right?
And that's the tooth.
Well played, well played.
I had about an hour to think of that, so...
But yeah, I just wanted to shed a little light, because I've always heard that joke about British teeth, and I've... Honestly, I've never really looked into it, and yeah, I thought it was kind of interesting that it's widely based on total lies and myths.
The more you know.
Do, do, do. We really do need to get that tune. Like, I need to download that, and I never do. And this is probably going to stay in just like this without me having gotten it, so I should seriously work on that one day.
We're all a cappella on this show.
While Ralph is being scared to death by British Smiles, Bart is busy in the lobby scaring the other children by claiming that the dentist is going to steal their teeth and sell them. When asked what they're going to use them for, Bart mentions that they're the things that make a can of spray paint make that rattling sound.
Which it makes sense, right? It sounds very much like that.
Sounds like teeth, I suppose. The dentist is examining Maggie next and notices that her teeth are starting to grow in a bit crooked and says, has she been sucking on a pacifier?
Not that I've noticed.
Lies! I love this, how cruel this dentist is. He's kind of a creepy dude, honestly. And a little bit of fun information about him as well. This part was actually originally offered to Anthony Hopkins.
Yep, I was going to say, without any knowledge of this, it reminds me of Silence of the Lambs. That's the way his voice reminded me of. Sorry, didn't mean to cut you off.
No, that's totally cool. I'm glad you got that vibe. It's kind of fun, because that was the original intention, but unfortunately, he turned them down. The part was then offered to Clint Eastwood, who also turned it down, but would have also been great in that role. And finally, and definitely the most sad, actually, is Anthony Perkins, who's most famous for playing the role of Norman Bates in the movie Psycho, actually agreed to play this part, but unfortunately, he passed away before he was able to record. And it turned out that Hank Azaria took over the role after this, but it had actually been agreed to go to Anthony Perkins, and everybody agreed that he would have been absolutely fantastic in that role.
Yeah, that would have been a little bit more creepy, but again, you can't go wrong with Hank Azaria. And honestly, I didn't even recognize Hank Azaria's voice here, but it makes sense, like, now that I know that when I hear it in my head. But it's just, again, going to be earlier years for Hank Azaria, so...
I think this is not the first time that we've come across to these points where Hank Azaria ends up coming in to clean up. And I think maybe, and I'm just speculating on this myself, but to some extent, it makes me wonder if just his versatility didn't land him getting more and more parts, because essentially when they needed somebody to fill in, he was able to do it.
I imagine that the casting director or producer probably sat down with the writers and they were like, okay, we can't get any of these people, and this happened, and, you know, there was a passing. Who can we get to do this? And they probably went, let's get Phil Hartman to do it. And then somebody was like, yeah, we've kind of tapped that well a little too much.
We don't want to dry the glue out. In addition to Maggie having crooked teeth, it turns out Lisa is also having issues. She's going to have braces, which I love Lisa's lines here. Oh no, I'm going to be socially awkward. More so.
I like that the computer has technology back in the early 90s to progressively show Lisa over the course of her young life, growing up to be 18 with, like, her tooth going through her cheek up by her eye. This is what Lisa will look like at 13. This is what Lisa will look like at 14. And here's what Lisa would look like at 18.
And then Bart's like, cool, she's a freak. Let's put her on a trailer, drive her through the South, and charge 2 bits a gander.
2 bits a gander.
I love when Bart just, like, gets into, like, these old, like, I don't know, it's like he's, like, turns into, like, a carny once in a while, and it's absolutely hilarious.
Well, I mean, Lisa had a line last week where I'll teach him to look at or mess with my tomato.
Yeah, but that's just more South than it is, like, carny. Like,
I
get, like, traveling salesman or, like, a snake oil salesman. That's what that makes me think of.
All right. Sorry, you said snake.
Wrong snake.
I think that was a pretty good snake right there, don't you?
That was a pretty good snake. You should be proud of that one. So back at the Simpsons home, Homer is a man after my own heart, because he is watching professional wrestling. And we have Dr. Hillbilly, who's going to be facing off in a Texas death match against the Iron Yuppie. It's going to be a fight for their masks and to the death. I love Homer. I hope he kills that Iron Yuppie. He thinks he's so great.
That makes me feel bad. Like, I just recently finished watching Glow, and it reminds me of the episode where she's not Indian, but whatever nationality she was, where, like, she was trying to play a terrorist, and the fans, like, started throwing stuff at her and spitting on her.
Dude, old school wrestling is amazing. Like, I still watch wrestling, but I'm a fan of, like, the territory days, because some of the stories that come off of the road from back then are just insane. When, like, it really was a time when the fans truly believed what was happening, and these heels would get so much heat in certain towns that people would literally try to kill them in the parking lots. There were shows where they had to be escorted to the ring, because there were fans in the auditorium that had blades that would try to jump over the railing and stab these guys. Like, it was legit.
You liked that?
Dude. Well, I love the stories. I love the idea of this. Again, dude, and you know I'm into magic, too. Like, I do a little bit of sleight of hand stuff, and I love watching, like, Penn and Teller and stuff. And I love the deception arts. I love the idea of these people being able to put on this show in front of you, and it's, like, all this giant work. And there's just this fun history to that that I really enjoy.
So you're saying you should become a professional wrestler whose gimmick is magic, and you could be Magic Miles?
I think they already stole a great movie title for my life story, unfortunately. Yeah. Stupid sexy Channing Tatum. Marge interrupts Homer's wrestling watching by letting him know that Lisa's gonna need some braces. But Homer's like, don't worry about it. We won dental coverage back in the strike of 88.
Which, that's a random fact for Homer to remember.
To be fair, he doesn't really remember the strike as much as that's how he got this scar on his head. And when we get to the flashback, you see everybody picketing, and they're fighting for fair wages and less corrupt management, or, you know, all the usual strike stuff. But as it pans out, we actually see Homer is over at a food truck while everybody else is chanting at their employer. Homer is just chanting, "Where's my burrito? Where's my burrito?" And he's pounding on the side of this food truck, which causes the door to actually swing shut and hit him on his head. And that leads him to telling the other story of the other scar on his head, Don't. Which was when he was trying to climb under that pay toilet door. Fucking Homer. Homer's a part of the International Brotherhood of Jazz Dancers, Pastry Chefs, and Nuclear Technicians, which is just this great, great mix-up of professions. I love their logo because it actually has a jazz dancer with his hands spread. In one hand, there's a cupcake, and the other, there's an atom.
Because you can see the atoms in their hands and pockets.
Yeah, exactly. Lenny opens up the meeting by announcing that their former union leader is missing, but they're all praying that he will show up alive and well, which gets the entire room laughing uproariously.
Wow. So many mob little wink-winks in this one.
Really dark, yeah. Lenny has an announcement to make. Good news, the plant has decided that they are going to start providing a keg of beer for each union meeting. And there's only one little tiny catch. They just have to trade their dental coverage for it. And in almost perfect unison, everybody is like, well, bye-bye dental plan. And they get in line for some delicious ice-cold free beer. And what's the best flavor of beer?
Duff?
Free beer.
Oh. Yeah, depends what kind of beer it is. Unless it's free.
That was absolutely my motto. If it was free, that's what I was drinking. Now I'm a little bit pickier. If it's Keystone, you can keep it.
Keep your Keystones. I'll have a Duff.
You have one too.
Oh, I guess I have two?
I still like your line from our 50th. You pay for two.
And this is the only time I've had that, oh my god, this is such a Family Guy moment. But again, this is years before Family Guy, so we could say Simpsons did it here.
Well, and what you're referring to, I don't think goes on excessively. Like, it goes on enough to be really funny, but it doesn't just keep going and going and going and going like a Family Guy joke often does. Essentially, what's happening is Homer is just in his head. You can see he's like,
he's standing in line to get the beer.
Yeah, and he's trying to remember, he's essentially trying to connect the dots. He just keeps repeating over and over again, dental plan, Lisa needs braces, dental plan, Lisa needs braces. And this does go on for quite a minute, until we actually get a prank where the guy behind him takes a pencil and drops it down his butt crack. Homer turns around and yells at Carl, even though it wasn't Carl who dropped the pencil. He says that you ruined my train of thought, but when he turns around, he just goes right back into the dental plan. Lisa needs braces.
And Carl said bullseye when the other guy dropped the pencil, so I think that's why I yelled at Carl.
Oh, fair enough.
And then I actually really like the line Homer said. I don't know why, but I just laughed really loud when he said it, because after this little bit, Homer goes, if we give up our dental plan, I'll have to pay for Lisa's braces.
Ah!
I don't know why, that just made me laugh, but I was like, he thought so long about dental plan. Lisa needs braces.
Well, I think that's why I like that joke so much, and why I don't like the... I get why you're comparing it to a Family Guy joke, but I don't think it goes over that line that the Family Guy joke would had. And in this case, they built it up just enough so that when Homer does make that declaration, you're kind of like slapping your forehead because, like, yeah, duh. But that's just how Homer's brain processes information.
And can we talk about the ingenious plan to give your union a keg of beer during every meeting? Like, Mr. Burns is a smart guy sometimes. This is a great idea.
Yeah, he plants a spy camera in the tap of the keg so he can keep an eye on what's going on during this union meeting. And he instantly identifies Homer as a leader that he needs to be worried about, because, to be fair to Homer, once he put those two pieces of information together and realized he did not want to have to pay for braces, he very quickly used his charm and appeal to get the entire room chanting with him to save the dental plan. I love, actually, some of the examples he uses. He mentions to Lenny, if it weren't for the dental plan, you wouldn't get to keep that diamond on your teeth.
Yoink.
Yeah. Somebody like jacks it as he's smiling about his diamond, they just rip it right out of his mouth.
Well, I like the duality of the keg thing. Like, the reason I brought it up is it's ingenious is if you get all the union members drunk, they're not going to get anything done.
Oh, you didn't even mean the camera aspect. You just mean intoxicating them.
It's a smart idea. Get them drunk and they're not going to talk about anything important. However, the fact that Homer becomes the de facto union leader might be because everybody else was getting drunk and they liked what he had to say.
That's a good point.
The plan backfired, Mr. Burns.
Homer has a couple other examples. He talks to Gummy Joe and says, where would you be without the dental plan? And Gummy Joe's like, well, I sure wouldn't have old Chomper here. And he uses his one lone tooth to open a can of pop.
And this is where it pans out to Mr. Burns watching the video, right?
Yeah, it's actually Homer starts to rip up the union contract that removes the dental plan, and everybody's cheering, and that's when we see the camera on the tap come to life, and that moment is what makes Mr. Burns think that Homer is this great leader.
It's a little bit better than that. I'm starting to really love the Mr. Burns lines overall, but I like this little snippet with him and Smithers in it, where he says, who is that firebrand Smithers?
That's Homer Simpson, sir.
Simpson, eh? New man?
Well, actually, sir, he thwarted your campaign for governor. You ran over his son. He saved the plant from meltdown. And his wife painted you in the nude.
It doesn't ring a bell.
I love that they actually make fun of this, because we've talked so many times where it's like, why doesn't Burns ever remember Homer? And the fact that they put a big old spotlight on that actually makes it way funnier.
Because he's so fucking old, that's why.
I think he's just more self-upset. He's a complete egomaniac. Yeah. He doesn't care about what's going on with other people.
Absolutely.
Back at the union meeting, everyone is chanting, Homer, Homer, Homer. He's the big hero, and they actually vote him for president. It was almost unanimous. It was all ayes and just one lone nay from the back.
Nay.
But Homer, for good or ill, is now the president of his union. His first question, which is a good one, what does this job pay? And Lenny points out, nothing.
Don't!
Unless you're crooked.
Woohoo!
And then this is a great little fadeaway, because they actually show two beers clank and a cheers on the very dead center of the screen. And when they pull away, it actually is what fades to black and brings us to our first act break.
Speaking of breaks, was that not a good icebreaker?
Oh, God. If nothing else, Marge is proud of Homer. She thinks it's great that he's the union leader, and even Lisa is really excited because of all the good that he can do for the working man. But Homer's much more excited about the connections he can make in organized crime.
And that's where we get Homer imagining himself as a mob boss walking down an old street, and I assume in Italy, I don't know, it's a la Godfather Part 2. And he's walking up to patrons on the street who are offering him donuts, tasting the donuts. And then a little old lady walks up asking for some help. And he picks up the donut again and eats it. And Miles, he says,
that's a good a donut.
That sounded much more mobster. I thought you were going to go Italian too much for a second, but That's not much, much more mobster. What's a moida?
Well, this scene is actually like another just shot for shot of The Godfather 2. It's based on the first appearance of Don Finucci in that movie, if you're familiar. And only in this case, he's accepting donuts rather than the necklace and the fruit that he takes in the movie. But it's almost exactly shot for shot, like they do so many times with so many movies. In the commentary, they actually mention that they've never really tried, but they might have enough footage of spoofs of The Godfather at this point that they could recreate pretty much the entire movie with just Simpsons clips.
That I would also watch.
Somebody needs to put that together if it doesn't already exist. I'll look more into that too. Lisa asks her father, "Do you think you can get the dental plan at work back?"
Depends who's a better negotiator, me or Mr. Burns.
"Hey, Dad, I'll trade you this delicious doorstop for that crummy old pastry."
"Deal." Don't!
Yeah, I love, there's actually like a real long delay where Homer's actually like really proud for a moment. He's got this doorstop and he's like static. But then as he slowly realizes that his son just conned him, there's that moment with a slow build-up to that glorious "Dope!"
And just the fact that it's like instantaneous gratification off of another line. Because like if he just said, "Depends who's a better negotiator, me or Mr. Burns," and then they cut to another scene,
it wouldn't be funny at all. I mean,
it doesn't do anything.
Sets it up, but it doesn't give a joke.
They immediately pay it off.
Yeah.
They immediately pay that line off. They give the line emphasis, which is
great writing.
Smart.
Really, yeah. Great writing. So next we're back at the dentist where Lisa's going to get her braces put on. The first set she's shown is great. They look great. They're invisible, they're painless, and periodically they actually release Calvin Klein for teeth.
Ooh, flashy. Or not flashy because you can't see it.
I love the whole concept because I'm surprised that doesn't actually exist in just like the corrupt world that we live in. Somebody hasn't tried to take advantage of designer braces. They probably do exist and I'm just unaware. Marge realizes that those are probably going to be out of their price range, and before letting her daughter get her hopes up too much, she lets the dentist know, "Hey, we're not actually covered on insurance right now, so we're going to need to look at some more affordable options." The dentist pulls out this monstrosity of a headgear that Lisa's going to have to wear and actually says that this predates stainless steel, so you can't get it wet.
Oh.
Dude, it's in your mouth.
Yeah.
How are you going to not get it wet?
Poor Lisa.
And it honestly, it looks like the like saw trap, the reverse bear trap that they use. Like,
yeah, it does.
That's what it looks like to me.
"Do you want to play a game where you can't drink water ever?
Or swim? Or bathe?" Because it's not like you can take braces off and on just at a whim.
You just gotta get in the shower with a bag over your head.
Like a kid with a cast on his arm, only it's your head.
Yeah.
Better shower quick before you pass out.
Yeah.
Back at the power plant, Burns is studying what he considers to be an admirable foe. He's watching Homer Simpson through the surveillance camera, and he sees that while all of the other employees have rushed off to the candy machine, Homer is spending time in his office and what appears to be he's working out, which doesn't seem quite like what Homer usually does, does it, Rich?
Well, considering I just met Mr. Simpson a little while ago, and he seems like a very good adversary, this does sound like Homer Simpson.
Well, in reality, Homer has somehow managed to get a sugar daddy stuck on his back, and he's wiggling around trying in an attempt to reach it and get it unstuck. He actually calls out to Lenny for help, and just another great bit of writing here. Lenny agrees to help him, but says, "But this is the last time, Homer."
It's like the old carrot in front of the donkey to get him to go trick with Mr. Burns here, where he doesn't see the snack that's making Homer move around.
Right, yeah, it's an allusion to Mr. Burns.
And then Burns calls Homer into his office so they can have a little exchange here.
Yeah, this is hands down my favorite part of the yep. episode. Burns is trying to offer Homer a bribe, but some of the wording he's using is a bit questionable.
What I like about it is, whenever in this scene, whenever you hear Homer talking, it's one of those moments where it's Homer's brain, and Homer's not actually saying anything until his last line in the scene. But Burns starts the conversation with Homer off, and he goes, "We don't have to be adversaries, Homer. We both want a fair union contract.
Why is Mr. Burns being so nice to me?
And if you scratch my back, I'll scratch yours.
Oh no, is he coming on to me?
I mean, if I should slip something into your pockets, what's the harm?
Oh my god, he is coming on to me.
After all, negotiations make strange bedfellows. Wink, wink.
Ah! The line he actually delivers is fantastic, too, because he says, Mr. Burns, I don't go in for these backdoor shenanigans. Don't get me wrong, I'm flattered, maybe even a little bit curious, but the answer is no.
I just like that they actually use the phrase backdoor shenanigans.
Dude, again, we've said it like 3 times already, but the writing in this episode is just fucking brilliant. Honestly, in the other episodes, it wasn't poorly written, but there was a lot more going on, and I feel like this episode is competitive with the other highly rated episodes, but in a very different way.
Where's Smithers when you need him?
Lisa's back in the dentist chair. It's actually time to get her braces put on, and the dentist is trying to calm her down by showing her all of the tools he'll be using. And it's things like the scraper, the poker, and the gouger. And keeping in the theme of this episode, they all individually look like things you might find in a Saw movie.
Or in a mob interrogation room.
True. He assures her that it won't be bad. They're just going to start by him chiseling a few new teeth out of her jawbone. Ow.
Oh.
That's awful.
Well, did you see the picture of her when she's 18?
Yeah, it's worth it, right? You don't want to have that tooth growing through your skull. Though you'll make a killing in the South, apparently, according to her brother.
Two bits of gander.
I love this next part. Lisa goes under the nitrous, the happy gas, and my god, I wish that I tripped like Lisa does. Like, she has the best drug reactions, because essentially, happy gas makes her live in a world that, I don't want to say it's a yellow submarine, because that seems like it might be copyright infringement, but let's call it a purple submersible, because that's what the Simpsons writer based this whole thing on.
I just like when she's actually tripping and seeing the Beatles, really like, it's Lisa in the sky, but no diamonds, though.
It's a really fun little bit, and just the whole Beatles gimmick in general, which actually this whole setup reminded me of Emmy Bede, who just recently contributed to our 50th show. If you haven't heard it, check that out, and shout out to her. She's way into classic music, and I always see her tweeting about the Beatles and classic music in general. So shout out to Emmy Bede, awesome chick. Check out her music on YouTube.
Whoop, whoop.
Once the braces are installed, Lisa requests a mirror. And this is our second Batman reference in this episode. We already got what I think was an homage, or not an homage, I'm sorry, a foreshadowing of Schwarzenegger as Mr. Freeze. This time, though, this was actually an actual spoof of the Batman movie, the 1989 Burton film, where Lisa asks for the mirror, very similar to the way Jack Nicholson does right after he's been turned into the Joker after the accident. Lisa looks at herself in the mirror, and she just starts having the same kind of Joker-ish style of laugh that Jack Nicholson had in the Batman movie.
What I liked about this is, even as a kid, I got this reference, too. Like, I remember seeing it and be like, oh, that's just like the Joker, where everyone else watches like, shut up, kid, we all know that.
The animators always do such a good job with these movie references, because if you're even remotely familiar with a movie, there'll be times, or even if it's been a while, or if it's something you're only vaguely familiar with, you'll see a shot and you're like, oh my god, that looks really familiar. Like, another great example is last week when we talked about the Clockwork Orange scene, where Bart is reaching up for the cupcakes, and it looks exactly like the scene where he's reaching up for the woman's breasts. Like, There's moments like that in The Simpsons throughout, and they're always just so well done that it evokes this response from you, even if, like the Batman thing, even as a kid.
Yeah, we've been knowing that for sure.
Lisa gets home, and she's very, very sad, borderline depressed about her new situation. Even Santa's little helper, who comes up to greet her, ends up just growling at her, running away in fear, actually, because she's so hideous.
Animal cruelty.
Just then, there's a knock at the door, and Homer asks, who is it?
Goons.
Goons?
Hired goons.
Homer opens the door, and I don't know what he's expecting, but there are two hired goons who take him off and essentially kidnap him to bring him to a meeting once again with Monty Burns.
Who's got the vulture that has the Monty Burns face on it. Nice little metaphor that's not little, and they're literally throwing it in your face.
So good. It looks exactly like Mr. Burns. And then they do this great little shot where it's a zoom-in shot on the vulture, but as they zoom out, it kind of comes around his head, and you see Mr. Burns take its place.
He's going to get that little arch in his neck.
Homer points out that if he wanted a meeting, he could have just called, but Mr. Burns feels like the phone is so impersonal. The only way to really be hands-on is with hired goons.
And I actually love this scene, because as soon as Mr. Burns says that, Homer goes, "Hired goons?" Like, he literally just did this bit a second ago where he didn't understand the concept. And they immediately go back to it in the very next moment.
If Homer wants to make these mob connections he's interested in, he's really going to have to learn more about hired goons.
Hired goons?
Mr. Burns starts to give Homer a tour of his home. And the first stop is the largest TV in the free world. It takes up an entire wall of Mr. Burns' home. And it has Homer absolutely mesmerized.
The part that sucks is, you know, in the early 90s, that TV would be super fat. Like, it'd be so big. It's not, we didn't have flat screens yet back then, right? Like, that thing would be so, take up so much wall space.
It would be like an entire room deep.
Yeah. Yeah. Exactly. That's what I'm trying to say.
Totally.
And you'd have to replace it, like, every few years with newer technology.
Mr. Burns also has a room entirely dedicated to keeping 1,000 monkeys handcuffed to 1,000 typewriters, where eventually they're going to create some genius novel. And I love Mr. Burns grabs the paper out of one of the typewriters and starts to read it.
"It was the best of times. It was the blurst of times, you stupid monkey."
I think it's important to note that on this tour, the entire time, Homer has had a beer stein in his hand, and he's been drinking. Burns takes Homer down to the basement, and Homer actually points out that this room's not nearly as nice as the others. I love Burns' response. "Yes, yes, I really need to quit ending the tour here." Immediately, Smithers starts to pour some coffee, and Burns wants to start negotiating the contract, but right away, Homer is like, "Oh god, why did I drink so much? I have to pee so bad." And there's like a drip going on in the basement. And just like you said earlier, Burns has some of the absolute greatest lines, including this whole little neck setup. Burns starts to say things like, "Homer, I know you're under a great deal of pressure, but I assure you, I just want to make this a whiz.
Kid,
I know you've got to keep your priorities number one. But if you listen to me, you're going to make a big splash." Finally, Homer just can't take it anymore.
I need to use the bathroom real quick.
It's the 23rd door on the left.
23, whoop whoop.
Burns once again confuses Homer's ineptitude and not being able to control how much he had drank with him being some sort of mastermind who's just refusing to even hear Burns out.
"He won't even listen to my negotiation."
And just another fantastic line, when Homer gets back, Burns asks him, "Did you find the bathroom okay?"
Yeah.
I just want to know what room Homer just pissed all over.
23 is a long way to go.
There's a ton of room options there, too, and Homer may have lost count at some point.
Burns will probably never even go back into whatever room he went into.
Yeah, the odds are slim that he'll ever even discover that pile of piss. Burns has given up, at least for this round. He drops Homer back off at his house via helicopter. Marge comes out to greet her husband, and I love that her hair actually gets chopped off by the helicopter blade. Then Mr. Burns starts talking a lot of shit, saying, like, "You won this round, but I'm gonna get you, Simpson. I'm gonna squash you like a bug." But Mr. Burns actually falls out of the helicopter as it's taking off. And the best part is, as he's being wrapped up by the medics, first of all, he asks Homer if he could rub his legs until the feeling comes back. But then even when he's being bandaged and taken away by Care Flight, Burns is still talking about how he's going to crush Homer like a bug.
Just another classic Monty Burns moment. An MBM. And then, much like any time there is any kind of Care Flight on The Simpsons, someone always gets their head hit. Oh. And as they take off, Mr. Burns
bonk.
It's just like right the Daredevil episode with Homer, yep. But this time it's Burns getting bonked around. Very funny stuff.
The Care Flight group at Springfield, just not on top-notch terms with anybody.
They really do not do a great job of securing their patient before taking off. Homer decides, after all this pressure, that he just wants to quit. He doesn't even know why he was made union leader to begin with. Marge assures him it's because everybody at the plant loves you, and Homer starts to reminisce about things like, yeah, you know, they do rub my head for good luck, and they like to pinch my belly until I giggle like a woman. That doesn't sound like they're your friends.
Hey, no. First thing tomorrow, I'm going to punch Lenny in the back of the head.
This is just a great fucking shot, because it's like a half a second long, but it just flashes to Lenny drinking coffee. You see Homer's fist come in and just wail him in the back of the head, and it immediately moves on to the next scene.
He stayed true to his word.
Brilliant little bit, though. Back with Lisa, she's at school with her new braces, and of course it's picture day, and she's just mortified. There's a funny little bit where Skinner's telling people to straighten up their hair, and he tells one child to uncross his eyes, and the kid's like, I can't. Oh, yes, sorry about that.
Oh, yes.
The photographer is desperately trying to get Lisa to smile, but she just refuses. And when she finally does, the photographer gets a look of horror on his face and declares, there is no God.
And that's the way all this stuff happens in real life. And that's what's so funny. It's, of course, she had to get braces right before picture day. Like, she would have known it was coming up already.
Right before picture day and right after they lost dental care. It was like the exact...
The perfect
time it needed to create this story.
I remember when I was in Little League Baseball, we had our baseball pictures taken the day after I got hit in the eye by the baseball. And I just had this huge black eye. It looked so bad because it nailed me. I was playing first base, and we had a kid with a little gimp in a step on third base. So when you warm up between innings and you're grounding the ball to everybody, it was a night game. And he threw that ball straight up in the light, and I stick my glove up, thinking I've covered my whole face, and that ball came down right beside the glove and nailed me right in the eye. And literally, this was like on a Saturday, and we had pictures the next day. So I show up, and I've just got this huge swollen black eye, and everyone's like, oh my god. And it almost looked like my father was hitting me or something. I don't know.
Did people show up at your house later that night and ask just a few questions about your living situation?
Come with us to the Flanders.
Exactly.
Oakley Doakley.
Things have escalated to the point where it is time to strike. Everyone's excited about it, they're all right behind Homer, and they are ready to fight for what they deserve. Once again, the vote to strike was unanimous minus one. You hear that one lone nay from the background.
Nay. Who keeps saying that? Then you get this like really short, scrawny guy that's standing up, and he's not very tall, and there's this huge jacked dude sitting down in the chair, and the scrawny guy goes, it's him, fellas. Let's get him.
Well, and then he does the classic bit where he's just like hanging outside the huddle of people beating him up, and he's snickering as he walks away clean.
The whole union goes after the buff guy beating the crap out of him.
Now on strike, Lisa has written a song for the occasion. It's actually a really, this is one of the great parts about this episode, is this whole little sequence, because they kind of cut in and out of Lisa singing her song and some of the actions that the people on strike are taking.
Come gather around, children, it's high time ye learns about a hero named Homer and a devil named Burns. We'll march till we drop, the girls and the fellas will fight till the death, or else fold like umbrellas. And then that's when it cuts away for a little while.
Yeah, so they do this great bit here where they actually start showing the actions that are going on during this protest, and the people on strike are actually rocking Wiggum's police car, but then it shows Wiggum inside just like napping comfortably as he's being rocked to sleep. Mr. Burns is like, you know what, let's just hire some strike breakers like we used to have back in the 30s.
Yeah, that'll work out great.
It's like Abe Simpson and Jasper and everybody from the Springfield retirement castle, and they're showing up in Burns' office. Well,
again, without Abe and Burns recognizing each other. This is killing me in all the early seasons.
Hellfish, not united. But Abe is saying, like, they can't break necks like they used to, but they've still got their ways, like, telling stories that don't go anywhere. Like that time I took the ferry to Shelbyville. Ferry ride cost 25 cents back then, and nickels had bees on them, so 5 bees for a ferry ticket, you'd say.
I love that. Pictures of bees on them.
This story just kept going and going. I mean, it got into, like...
He's got an onion belt.
He's
or
got
something.
An onion belt. Yeah, that was the style of the time.
That was the style of the time.
So, and even more icing on this little, like, long-winded story, it keeps showing Burns and Smithers, who are just clearly getting more and more bored, which is funny in itself, just because Burns is constantly going on these, like, old rambling stories. So you'd think of all people, he'd be the target audience. But once again, Burns only cares about himself.
Burns has these eccentric words that he says all the time where Grandpa just gets absurd.
He just goes off on a complete and utter, like, total derail. You know what? Abe Simpson should do a spot on the Derailer. Shout out to all three of the Derailers. That would be the perfect fit for their podcast, where they just literally start with a topic and just go where it takes them. Abe would, I mean, the only problem is time restraints with Abe Simpson.
It's all right. You could cut him down a little bit, but would you want to?
Never. Never. But finally, Burns has had enough, and he decides he's going to spray down the protesters with a fire hose. He yells out to Smithers, "Full power!" But full power turned out to be a little bit too much. In the classic cartoon style, we see Burns flying around, the hose just flapping under the power of the water. That's when it cuts in, and we hear the conclusion of Lisa's song.
So we'll march day and night by the big cooling tower. They have the plan, but we have the power.
And then as Lisa's song ends, I love this little bit too, because Lenny actually walks up to her and is like, "Hey, can you play Classical Gas next?"
Oh no, Lenny.
Which classical...
There's a reason you got punched in the back of the head.
Hey, I actually really like that song. I thought it was a cool jam, and Lisa nailed it. Fun little fact about the animation on this one. The Simpsons writers often try to get the animation into the hands of people that they know will specifically be good for certain parts. And I'm sorry, I should have this and I don't, but the animator on the episode was a guitar player, so they actually gave the part with Lisa to him. And while playing guitar, all of her fingers are actually in the correct chord positions.
Wow.
Yeah, most of the time it's very generic guitar playing, yeah. But if you watch, you can actually tell they made an effort to actually make it look like she was truly playing that guitar.
So you can play this song yourself if you pay attention.
Yeah, just slow it down and learn how to do it with four fingers. Yeah. At the end of this sequence, we once again see that Homer is drawn to the food truck, and Burns is still obsessed with him, thinking that he is this mastermind that he is going to have to contend with.
Look at him. He thinks he's cock of the yard. Homer Simpson is cock of nothing.
The look on Smithers' face here is just
Smithers literally goes, "Hmm?"
But he gets like, you can see like a little twinkle in his eye.
Twinkle in his eye, but yeah, never mind.
Burns and Smithers decide, you know what, enough of this nonsense. We can just run the plant ourselves. And there's this great little montage where Burns and Smithers are dancing and frolicking around the plants and getting everything done without issue is the impressive part. But things do go wrong when they decide to get worker robots that are 100% loyal until they're not, because just like every time the Simpsons deal with robots, these robots turn on man and start to try to kill Burns and Smithers. Must kill, destroy.
One of their usual Simpsons writing tropes, along with the Homer brain segments, I guess, where they like dipping into this well.
They love killer robots.
Hilarious results. It's always funny.
Has not been a dull moment yet when it comes to the Simpsons crew getting chased by a scary robot.
Funny that there's a conversation about Homer thinking something was coming on to him and having killer robots. And they're going to combine these two efforts in a much later episode that I think we all know and love.
True story. We'll get there for sure. So now we've got Homer, the union leader, squaring off against Mr. Burns on the show Smartline with Kent Brockman. And for some reason, television personality Dr. Joyce Brothers is actually on the panel as well. This is actually Dr. Joyce Brothers doing a one-line cameo on the show, and she actually delivered the line, I brought my own microphone, which gave me like a Ralph Wiggum type of vibe.
And then we get the actual interview with Brockman and Homer. Brockman starts telling him, Mr. Simpson, organized labor has been called a lumbering dinosaur.
Ah!
My director is telling me not to talk to you anymore.
Woo!
Mr. Burns, you asked for an opening tirade.
And this is where Mr. Burns declares that in 15 minutes he is going to wreak havoc upon the town. On everyone he'll be getting his revenge. Every single resident. And then Grant Brockman just cuts the commercial with, what a chilling sentence of things to come.
It's very newscasty.
We move into our third act, and we see that Mr. Burns and Smithers clearly have some sort of evil plan. They're moving through the power plant, and there's a spoof of the old show Get Smart, where they're going through chamber by chamber, room by room, puzzle by puzzle. Then they do a little bit of 1960s Batman, and they even get a little bit of the Addams Family with the spinning bookshelves and the creepy location. And all this is to get to a secret bunker. But I love this bit. Actually, I both love it and hate it, and you know why. But I love this bit when they walk through, they see that the back door was just left open after they went through all this trouble to get their secret lair. And there's actually a stray dog that walks in. And the part that does, I know I flip-flop on this, I don't know why, but it truly upsets me when Mr. Burns kicks the dog.
It's just a cartoon dog.
I know. I'm not, like, gonna, like, join PETA or, like, any other terrorist organizations, but... I admittedly, like, just the whole idea of, like, him kicking a dog just upsets me. It does help comfort me to know that Mr. Burns is often toppled by insects, so potentially the dog just felt like he was getting a belly rub.
He's trying to give Burns a win. Burns is going through some tough times right now.
But all of this was so he could turn off the town's power. That was the big plan, is he was just going to eliminate power from Springfield.
Goodbye, Springfield. From hell's heart, I stab at thee.
During the blackout, I love there's this electronic sign that announces the Springfield blackout that's still running. So Burns is, I guess, to some extent celebrating. He feels like he has got the upper hand on the town, and it's just a matter of time before they will cave in and go back to work. But as he sits on his balcony and overlooks his town that's now in total darkness... Lisa's
overlooking the town in a very Seussical way.
Oh yeah, the animation does have some like Dr. Seuss like bits to it, I guess you could say.
Grinch Stole Christmas stuff.
And we see Lisa start strumming the guitar again, and she starts singing that last chorus from her song. Well, march day and night by the big cooling tower. They have the plant, but we have the power.
And then Mr. Burns leans out in a very Grinch-like fashion, obviously, and starts saying, look at them all through the darkness I'm bringing. They're not sad at all. They're actually singing. They sing without juicers. They sing without blenders. They sing without flungers, cap dobblers, and smendlers.
Very, very Seuss. And I love when they do this, actually, with Mr. Burns especially. It really works, the parallels with him and the Grinch.
Dude, and again, like, I've been saying it since season one, pretty much. How great of a character is this guy? Like... he's got so many extravagant lines that just make you crack up. Like, you hate him, but coming back and actually taking a closer look at him, he's such a vivid character to me.
He's great. And his next bit is great, too. He actually calls Homer in for a meeting. He admits failure. He essentially is like, this guy has outplayed me. And he agrees he will give the dental plan back as long as Homer agrees to resign as the union president. So it's the biggest win-win possible for Homer. He does his classic woohoo, and then he starts doing this like run around in a circle dance, and Burns delivers yet another great line. Smithers, I'm beginning to think that Homer Simpson was not the brilliant tactician that I thought he was.
Very subtle, Mr. Burns. This is an iconic moment in Simpsons history when Homer's literally like dancing around on the floor going woo, 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 when he's doing his little, I used to call it the chicken dance when I was
makes
little.
Sense. Not no, because I the get actual it. Chicken the dance. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And he's literally like spinning around on the floor, and they'll go back to this a few times in the show, but this is the first time I really remember them doing it, and it's just hilarious. Every time I see it, it makes me bust out laughing. And I don't know if we really touched on it much earlier, but like Homer was kind of starting to crack under the pressure of being the union leader, so that's why it's so win-win for him at the end, because he does not want to do it anymore.
Oh, yeah, he didn't want to do it from the get-go, really. Yeah. He really didn't want any of the extra responsibility, especially when it came with no pay. Burns does stick true to his word. He turns the power back on. Homer announces that everyone's going back to work. They all celebrate. We see the red light district reopen. We see the fake vomit factory reopen. And we see Lisa finally getting the comfortable braces that she wanted from the get-go, and you can't even see them. And then, of course, she delivers the great, great joke that gets the whole room laughing hysterically, and that's the tooth. Oops. Uh-oh, I left the gas on.
We're idiots.
And they just laugh through the fucking credits. It's actually really funny. And I don't usually like the super fast resets, but this reset was really well done. Like they concluded this in a great way, and admittedly they kind of got themselves to the end of the rope where they didn't really have a lot to do to get it back to normal. So I think this was actually a really smart choice.
What I want to know is, does this mean to this day that Lisa still has the invisible braces on?
Maybe Nelson can tell us.
Ha ha!
But that does bring us to the end of Last Springfield. No.
Last Springfield on the left. The creepy horror movie.
But that does bring us to the end of Last Exit to Springfield, one of three of the highest rated episodes of season 4 and of the entire series in general. Rich, were there any other thoughts that you had or anything that your book wanted to point out on this episode?
Not a lot to point out from my book on this episode. They did want to point out, again, this is The Simpsons, A Complete Guide to Our Favorite Family. It did want to point out that the red light district, the places you can actually see there, Nudes at 11, Adam and Adam, and the Horny Toad.
Nice.
And then also I wanted to point out, we recently did an interview with Derek from The Wild Pitch, and he told us that he thinks this might be his favorite episode ever of The Simpsons.
That's a very popular opinion. This is constantly featured on the top list. In fact, in 2003, which is now, that's 13 episodes worth of The Simpsons. In 2003, Entertainment Weekly declared this number one on their list of top 25 Simpsons episodes of all time.
Damn.
I'll be honest, I think this episode is slightly overranked. And I don't mean in any way, shape, or form to say that it's not a fantastic episode. And I actually think it was yet another episode that was better watching as an adult, because there was a at least probably a fifth of the episode that I just did not get as a child.
Absolutely.
So this watching it back now is a lot funnier, and I still think that it's overrated in the sense that I don't think this deserves to be on the same level as Homer the Heretic or Marge versus the Monorail or even Homer at the Bat, which it's rated tied with or better than all three of those episodes I just mentioned.
Yeah, it's like you said, we're not sliding the episode at all. It's just, it doesn't feel like it deserves to be up there, but when you look at it in a closer sense, like we did today, there's so many fantastic moments. It's okay to admit that it's a great, great episode, but it's just not quite all the way up at the top. And again, I think a lot of it for me, like I said at the top of our episode here, is that it has to do with a dental plan. But what comes from that are a lot of great individual moments, especially all the Burns moments, which I just can't get enough of right now. It's just
Burns steals the show in this episode,
absolutely,
hands down.
Absolutely.
Like, it's not even a close second, even with some of the great Homer lines he has. Homer does not even touch the tip of the iceberg where Burns hits in terms of the humor on this episode.
Right. I couldn't have said that better.
On that note, I think that's going to do it for Last Exit to Springfield. Rich, is there anything you want to plug before we get out of here?
As always, you can follow me on Twitter. I'm at @thewiz_kid23. Also, while you're on Twitter, go ahead and give our show a follow. That's @bestdarndidly. That's DIDDLY. And I mentioned this a few minutes ago. Miles and I recently did an interview about our show with Derek, who's the host of The Wild Pitch. So if you guys want to check that out, check him out on Twitter. It's @WildPitchCast. So check us out on there. It was a lot of fun doing that. And we'll be doing another segment on his show relatively soon.
Yeah, we'll actually be able to make a pitch, which we're both really excited for. Yeah, Derek's a great guy. Shout out to him. Check out his show @WildPitchCast, especially the episode that we are on, because it's clearly the best one.
And the diddliest.
And the diddliest. For me, I'm online at Mr. Most Days Off. That works pretty much everywhere. Everything Best Darn Diddly, best place to find that is bestdarndiddly.com. And of course, we're also everywhere like iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, Pod Paradise, Podbean. Anywhere you can find a podcast to listen to, we try to post it there for you. Other than that, just want to say once again, thank you so much for listening to the Best Darn Diddly Review Show. We have a blast going through and reviewing these episodes, and we have even more fun talking with all of you about it online. So please interact, keep in touch with us there. Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, wherever you like to talk on the internet, we're there to talk with you. So hit us up. The WizKid and I look forward to being back with you next week. It's going to be a little bit of a different episode because we're going to be talking about So It's Come to This, a Simpsons clip show.
And to both of us here, you're all the cocks of nothing. So have an ice day.
Wow, had to go one more. I love it. Until next time, be cromulent to each other.
Every year, new TV shows get canceled. Some make it an entire season, and some don't even make it that far. I'm Ed, host of Unaired, where each week we review a show that was canceled with episodes left unaired, then pitch our ideas for what could have been future episodes of those shows. We've covered shows like Cavemen, the show based on the Geico Cavemen commercials, the ill-fated 2011 Wonder Woman pilot, a show called Look Well, where Adam West plays an aging TV detective who thinks he can solve real crimes, and many more. You can find us on iTunes, Google Play, unairedpodcast.com, or wherever you download podcasts. And remember, some things are better left unaired.